I'm at Zealand Luxury Villa right here in Colombo on our episode of Danu on Fire, made possible by our friends at LICC Jeans right here on Hi TV, your luxury channel. Today, I'm excited about seeing someone who is a cricketing star and at the same time about what is he up to these days. All with Danu on Fire with Maruf. And to be merry, I have Maruf. How are you doing today?
Very good, Danu. Thank you.
And thank you so very much for joining us on the show. I have not seen you around in quite some time. We once walked the ramp together. If you do remember, we all went for measurements.
Yeah.
That was the last I actually saw you properly, and after that, lost in transition.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about what's keeping you busy these days, apart from the fact that you are involved with cricket. What else?
I mean, I'm just retired last year, October, from full-time with my domestic and international game as well. And ever since then, I've been busy trying to promote the game, basically. So I was appointed as a junior selection committee in the national setup last January. And then last April, I was appointed the under-19 national team manager. So that keeps me busy, apart from my MAS job, which I've been having for the last 15 years, playing Kerala cricket for them and also full-time with them. So those three keeps me busy at the moment.
So when you say under 19 cricket, you know, it's something that where whole of Sri Lanka is now very worried about cricket.
Yeah.
Although we do see like those little moments where cricket is celebrated. And I think we come from a nation that's very forgiving and very loving towards the team. I think whoever is those 11 men who go out there to represent us on the field, we love them no matter what.
True.
And that's amazing. I think that as a country, I think we have always embodied that. Tell me, what do you think is the key issue today in us falling in love with cricketing personalities, because we tend to not follow up on these people because they're gone. That's it.
I think inconsistency.
Okay.
I mean, if you're spot on there, because you know, nowadays you don't see much experienced players coming through.
Yeah, and also you can't follow their journey because they're not there.
The transit periods happened since Mahela Kumar and all these guys retired, and recently Lasith retired. So all these players who have been performing and been in the scene for a long time are slowly but surely, you know, going away from the game and they're doing their own thing.
Do you feel cricket needs star factor?
I mean, you've got to be earning that. So if as a player, you know, star factor come if you perform. So it's like anyone's job, right? I mean, you go out there, you perform to your best and you get that status and you have to maintain that. How do you maintain that is something that you, what you show in the field, as well as in public, in normal life, how you behave yourself. So all these things, little thing matters. And as you said, you know, nowadays the senior players are lesser. And even the senior players, some players do get dropped. And whereas those days, in our era, the senior players were the core of the team.
And they were there for quite
a long time. So, you know, I probably agree with you there. I mean, our boys who are in the system now, it's their best chance to put their hand up
and shine.
Shine and claim that spot. I mean, places are up for grabs.
Yeah, that's
so you got to make sure that once you get that opportunity to, you know, really grab it and not let anyone have.
All right. So that's a little bit about cricket. I'm going to speak to him more about other things because those are the fun parts of it. So just to let you know, he loves this place and we are so happy that we were able to shoot here because we were going to shoot somewhere else, but we changed locations. And I have always loved this place for the ambience and definitely the interior. That's breathtakingly beautiful. They have multiple restaurants, but we are here is at the Veranda. You can check it out. They have all types of food here. It's a 24 operation in terms of food you can enjoy at any given time while you're here. And tell me, how long have you been coming here for? You seem to know everyone, including the doors are talking to you.
I know this place for quite a while, and I know the head chef. I usually come there. I love Japanese food.
Okay, so at the Zen on top.
At the Zen, at the second floor in the rooftop. So usually come over whenever, you know, time permits to go out and have a
But I must meal. Say, very good Japanese here.
Lovely.
And the portions are fabulous.
Yeah, it's quite reasonable as well.
Yeah.
It's not expensive, it's reasonable and it fills you and you just want to come back again over and over
again. That is true. Yeah, so that's great. So now that you like the place, we're happy. So we forced you to enjoy food at the Veranda. So what What is your type of food? What do you like to eat? I think we should say cheers to life. I'll give this to you because it's quite far away. And he likes passion, and he actually commented on the selection not done by me. I don't even know what I will end up eating until I come here. I am that disorganized.
The food is generally in New Zealand, and whatever you get,
it's very good.
It's fantastic. So
I know.
No complaints.
Portions are lavish. You can dig in. Don't feel shy.
Thank you.
This show is about food. How do you stay thin? I just want a tip.
How do I say thin?
Are you born
hardly
this
go
way?
To the gym?
Are you born this? You're born.
Yeah,
this
I'm,
way?
I'm probably genetic. I mean, in
terrible.
My family.
Old people are just terrible.
But I also, once you retire, that's where you need to work out because.
Don't use that word retire when you have moved on to the second chapter of life.
What I'm saying, when I retire from the sport that I've been doing for the last 20 odd years, it's easy to lose that interest, but you just have to maintain the discipline of life when it comes to training. It's very important. So I'm a big believer of maintaining training whenever possible.
Mm.
So that's exactly what I do. Other than that, I eat everything, I drink everything. So it doesn't really matter.
Doesn't matter exactly how you go because I think you have just remained in shape. tell me now, we have seen cricketing side to you. How are you at home? What is your personality at home?
Simple. I take life as it comes. And I have a young family, so I give a lot of time to my kids now, which I failed to do a few years ago with my cricketing commitment. So nowadays, it's my family that most of the time I spend with. His kids started schooling recently.
Mm.
So keeping busy with that as well. So, you know, giving something back to them, which they were missing in the younger days.
Is it always a sacrifice? You know, this is like the line that all cricketers have said. It's like everyone's line, or the fact that it's always the travel, it's always the tour, and the kids have to remain here because they have to go to school.
Even when you're in Sri Lanka, you train. So once you leave at home, leave home around 6:30 in the morning, by the time you finish training and come back, it'll be after lunch. So you come back and have a nap.
You're knackered.
And knackered, and you have a nap, and you come, you wake up, it'll be late evening.
Yeah.
So half of the day is gone. So even though you're in Sri Lanka, still your time you spend with the family is quite less.
Mm.
So nowadays, once I'm taking the other step, once I've started, finished playing, I mean, I have more time for them.
Mm.
I mean, that also depends on my workload with the logistical stuff with the under-19 setup.
Mm.
But I make sure whenever time permits, I give them the time that they want from a father.
Now, you come from a Muslim family. Yeah. Celebrations are big for you all.
True.
And celebrations are big. We wait for the Muslim celebrations because
we
are like, who is giving the biryani now? It's always the Facebook status that goes up.
True.
How are celebrations at home for you?
Massive.
Who is the best cook, mom or wife?
I'm going to get in trouble now. I mean, usually every celebration, it's
now answer that really first, mom or wife.
I got to say it, it's my mom.
Right, okay.
You know, this is no second thought about it.
There you go, you are, at least you have your birth home to go to. Okay, so tell me about...
Usually our festival, we have lunch at my mom's place. Mm. So that's
a tradition
we've been carrying for a long time. And breakfast at my mother-in-law. So
okay.
That's the trend, to keep them both happy.
There you go.
And have our own downtime as a family for dinner.
Dinner, okay.
So that's the usual routine. Just happened at this past Hajj as well. Lots of biryani, lots of vatlapang, so simple life.
So in terms of this biryani, it's such a staple Sri Lankan favorite. Are you a biryani fan?
Love it.
Excellent.
Love it.
On that note, he spoke about his family side. There's so much more to it because I think the dad in him has kicked out to do some great things. We're going to speak more about it, of course, when we do come back right here on Dano on Fire, made possible by LICC Jeans on the other side. You're watching Hi TV, your luxury channel. It's Danu on Fire and we are dining at the Veranda. You need to come check out the food here. I'm having barramundi, this brilliant fish that's just pan fried and grilled perfectly. You're just having a massive burger, that's about it. I just gave him the starch even. I'm like, you can afford to. I can't. So just be fair by me.
Once a week, a cheat day is fine.
Yeah. This is my second cheat day. This is my second shoot for the week. I'll just look like a horse by the time I'm done with this show. This is with a lot of trial and error that this body has remained this size. I'm telling you.
This is for us, you know, something that we don't usually get at home.
What?
burgers for us.
Yes, that's true. All right, so tell me now, before we went to the break, we spoke a little bit about what he's doing in terms of children and kids, and this is something very special. He has worked on education, and that's your new venture that's coming out in September.
Yep, it's trying to open a preschool and a daycare.
Okay.
So it's like an investment involving educators who are experienced working abroad as well, so I'm very lucky.
Don't you think the market is cluttered for this?
I mean, I just want to make a change. It's easy for me to invest in something else, like restaurants or whatever.
Yeah.
But for me,
cricketers and restaurants have become the trend.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I just want to make a change. Mm. So start from the scratch, because we need to get the international standards coming to Sri Lanka.
Mm.
So as I said, I'm very lucky to have a good team who have educated abroad.
Mm.
So bringing them down and starting the investment plans next month. So that's called www.footstepscmb.com. So any viewers can go and check it out. So it's going to be preschool plus daycare for the kids.
Okay, what's going to be special about it? Or the fact that these are all professionally trained?
I mean, it's all professionally trained teachers. And I just want to make a change. Because, you know, giving the best education when they're young is very special. And I think that should be the step forward.
Yeah.
And make a change, to be honest. I mean, you find so many things going on with school kids. I mean, because the education in younger age has maybe not been nurtured properly.
So that's true.
Thinking of that side, the investment is going to happen from next month. So it's a long process. So I just hope that, you know, everything falls in place.
All right. You know, we'll get into our food.
Bon appetit.
Yes. Don't stick to the salad, I'll know it. I'm right in front of you.
Don't worry, I'm good with fries as well.
And try the burger too.
I will.
Okay. I love mango in salads.
Lovely.
It's the best thing that... Mango is the best fruit out there.
Tropical.
So, your hometown is close to the Hivalo. How are the Hivalo?
No. I was born in Maligavatta.
Okay.
At the moment, I'm living in Navalo. But my investment, the preschool and daycare is going to happen in Devala. So that's where it's going.
Something to do with Devala came about. Okay, when you were growing up, what made you think that you had cricket in you? Everyone has cricket. Hello, look at me. Even I played cricket on the road, okay, down Arithusa Lane. Everyone laughed at me, so I also wanted to be a cricketer. But tell me, what did you see in you that you thought you could give it a try?
Good question. I mean, probably the interest. I followed a lot. I started playing when I was 8.
But who discovered you?
Probably myself.
No, but who saw you and like put you into...
I mean, that's my father.
Oh, really?
He really saw something in me while playing softball, like in the roads in Colombo 10. So that's where it started, and my father saw something, because my father is a big cricket fan, even my mother.
Oh, really?
So they encouraged me. I only didn't play cricket at school. So I played rugby, I played football, I played basketball.
You never played cricket in school?
I played other sports as well.
Okay.
Like rugby, football, basketball, till I was 13. And then the school masters said, you just have to concentrate on cricket because we see a good future in that.
Yeah, and also cricket. You can't do a lot of things when you're playing. You can't play rugby when you're playing cricket.
Some do, but my passion was sport. So I just want to do it. But, you know, I thought I was lucky. I had a school master who advised not to concentrate too much on that, because we see something good in cricket. So just concentrate on that. So around 12 years, I stopped everything and just concentrated on cricket. I think I had to thank the school masters and my father at that time.
Now, what I wanted to ask you is, now, Sri Lanka recently went through such a terrible setback on the 21st of April. Now, we all know this.
Yeah.
And religion became the most highlighted problem in our country. Till then, there was language issues. You know, we had discrimination over the fact of Tamils. I'm saying
true,
this because...
Yeah, we could go through that.
Yeah, because I came from the north, and life was not easy, because until the war ended, everyone saw everyone as a terrorist or somebody who could attack. How was it for you? And especially coming from the Muslim background, and also you have worked with people from all walks of life. You all have worked in teams which nobody even bothered to ask, what do you speak or where do you pray? Yeah. You know, they all just saw you as a fellow mate. How did you see this problem brewing, and how do you see it today?
I thought, I mean, initially when it happened on the 21st, I mean, that's one of the probably the hardest days I personally had. I mean, if I'm being really honest, it took about a week to overcome it.
I know.
Because being a Muslim, I mean, in Sri Lanka, I mean, you know how it is. I mean, most of the time, Muslims don't only stay with Muslims. We always share the dressing room or share fun times with other religion, people of other religions as well.
Yeah.
But when this happened,
if I'm being really honest, I was a bit ashamed to show my face because I have nothing to do with it. But being a Muslim, and it happened with, you know, some extremist, which I don't think.
I think there are extremists in everything.
Yeah, I mean, this is something, Dano, that no one even dreamt of. Mm. So even we didn't know what NTJ was.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the first time I've heard of it. But being a Muslim, it was definitely a hard time when it happened. But eventually things, go with flow, and you know, eventually we are over it. But when it happened, it was one of the toughest times as a Muslim I went through, because, you know, not only me, I'm pretty sure that most of the Muslims who live in Colombo or maybe in the other cities would have felt the same. But, you know, overall, and I always say we are Sri Lankans, you know, Muslims.
And also, you have represented Sri Lanka as someone who wants to win for the nation, not for a religion or a language or anything like that.
I mean, when we used to play, like you take Morali from Russell to Sanat to Mahela Kumar, there's no religion barrier there. I mean, never thought of it, never spoke about it. But, you know, the sad part was there's so many stories, especially in social media, coming through with all this after the 21st attack. So it wasn't a pleasant thing. It was very hard. But eventually, as all Sri Lankans do, we forgive and we move on. So I'm lucky and I'm happy that we came across that bit of a hurdle.
Yeah, but it's just an unfortunate situation. The reason why I asked you was, you know, it's one thing to like speak from it from an outside point of view, but when you are actually a part of that religion and when you're looked upon in different ways, just by a minute's action, you're just thinking to yourself, what did I do?
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, some of the things
that people end up saying, you're shocked, right?
I mean, I had to block, I mean, I haven't shared anything anywhere, this information. I had to block few of my mates as well on social media for some of the things they've been commenting and posting.
And
it's sad. I mean, we live together for so long time.
I know.
And we know the families as well.
And like
and
one thing,
and they they didn't suspect me, but overall, it's a big hit.
But the emotions that trigger can just be very painful. You're like,
I mean, what you can't do is you can't let emotions take over and make decisions.
Mm.
So that's something wrong, and you have to think of the other person. You got to respect that.
Yeah.
So some people who post a certain few things in social media was very hurtful, and in the end, I had to block them.
Mm.
And it was very, it hurts a lot saying it, because we know the people for a long time, and suddenly one thing happens like this, and they put all of us in that category, which is very sad.
That's true. All right, a bit of a serious note. Please eat your fries at least. Put on some starch in the process. Just get these people fat. Let's get into a break. We'll see you on the other side with our final segment as we join you with something sweet at the veranda. All this and more on the other side. This stunning villa has so much to offer in the heart of Colombo that makes it so much more better. It's such a getaway in the city life. Welcome to my final segment with you right here on Dano on Fire on Hi TV, your luxury channel, in conversation with Mr. Maruf. So we spoke about, okay, it's dessert time. I don't like to waste time on this.
I like favorite time.
Yes. Are you a sweet person?
I am.
Okay. We have got the classic chocolate mousse. Is it chocolate mousse or chocolate brownie?
Chocolate mousse.
Let's just dig in and see. I'm sure there's some surprise. There is a brownie inside. I knew it. All right. So, are you a sweet person?
I am.
Really?
I love sweet.
Ah, okay. Can you cook to save your soul?
No.
Nothing?
I can't cook.
At all?
I've tried a couple of times, but...
How has it
miserably failed.
Has anybody eaten it?
Unfortunately, no.
Or fortunately, yes.
Fortunately, no.
Fortunately, no, as well. All right, so now when you all used to tour, when you go out of the country for many weeks or months, how do you all survive with food? Like, are you all on a strict regime diet?
Not really. I mean, if you go to countries like Australia, New Zealand, and England, places like England, you get Sri Lankan restaurants, and you get, you know, Chinese, Indian, which we are comfortable with.
Mm.
But the hardest part would be traveling to West Indies.
Okay.
I found it that West Indies food is very different to what our palate is.
Mm.
So what we do is most of the time we take our food from here, especially West Indies. So on tour, it's about
us. Who makes it?
We get the canned bottles, the sealed bottles.
Right, okay.
We buy from here and take it over.
Okay.
Sometimes the family cooks for us and
like a humble, it just takes
you need it, especially in West Indies, but in places like England, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, and all these places will offer different varieties. But when it comes to West Indies, it's all beach life, so it's meat, it's rice. You know, we'll miss
very
that.
Chilled.
It's too. I mean, as you say, West Indians are laid back.
They're so super laid back.
Lifestyle is such as well as.
So that's what when Sri Lankans, when they expect us to do things really fast, we can't. We come from an island.
Absolutely.
We like to chill for everything. Chill. That's all we like to do. Anyway, something that I wanted to ask you in terms of looking back today, do you think you would have enjoyed cricket today, or you were happy that you played it at the time you played?
I think the time I played this career span for international for 12 years, I think I've gained a lot, and I've made a lot of friends for life, made a name for myself, if I'm being really honest. I mean, I can't compare playing those days and nowadays. The era is two different eras, because the era I played, we had some fantastic big names who continuously played for a long time, and we were understudies, and it was quite easy for us, because they were the limelight. We were just, backing with the simple plan. But it's hard to compare the two eras that we spoke, I mean, what you're talking about. But I'm pretty happy with the career I had. It was halted by a lot of injuries, I should say.
But did you achieve all that you wanted to achieve in cricket?
I mean, if I say yes, I'd be lying. I think I would have loved to achieve more. But my body didn't allow me to, because I had a lot of injuries to go through. So, I mean, I'm happy the place I am, but I could have done a little bit more. I mean, just that my body wasn't up for it. So, apart from that, I've given everything. I mean, I've never left anything to bring back. I have everything left in the grounds, and every time I played, I've played it right. So, I reckon looking back at my career, not only international cricket, domestic cricket, and IPL, and all this cricket, I think I've achieved a lot. I'm pretty proud to call myself an ex-professional cricketer.
Who was your biggest fan when you were playing?
When I started?
Or like even up to date, who would you say is your biggest fan?
I would say fan and critic would be my parents.
Okay. Yeah, because both of them like cricket.
Yeah, they love both. And my mother never criticized me. Okay. She always encouraged, as all mothers are.
Yeah.
But when it comes to father, he'll make sure that if I do something wrong, he'll say it, because he can't hold back.
Yeah.
But those two definitely was my fans and critic big time. And once I met my wife, I mean, she started watching cricket. When I started dating her, she knew about cricket. So that was the best part.
Oh, really?
So it took some time for her to understand the game of cricket. But now she's like acts like expert now. She tells me, you could have done this, you could have done that. So that's how the life changes.
Well, thank you so very much for joining me on Down on Fire. It has been amazing.
Pleasure.
Thanks for sharing a meal with me. And at the same time, I can't wait to see your new venture going strong and, going places. I wish you all the very best.
Thank you, Donald. That's a wrap on
Down on Fire. It has been absolutely amazing getting to know him. If you have not seen him around, that's because he's busy with 100 other things that he's doing. So happy to have him on the show. We'll see you with another brilliant episode to Down on Fire. Till then, big thank you to everyone here who gave us brilliant hospitality at the Veranda. Make sure you come and check out the food. Until I see you soon, you keep smiling.